Shut up, compressor. Hey everyone, Matt here with Doogs Models, and welcome to the next installment of the Black Basing 201 series. This time out, we're going to be tackling something that seems to be a matter of concern for a lot of modelers who are hesitant to give black primer a try, and that is putting really light colors over black. Now, when I say light colors, I'm not talking about the light ghost grays and things like that of the world. I'm talking about things like white or red. Colors that traditionally have the impression, reputation, whatever you want to call it, of not going down well over a dark color. I mean, how many times on a forum or in a comment on some Facebook group or wherever else have you come across the old adage that you have to put white underneath yellow or underneath red in order to make it really pop? It doesn't hurt if that's what you're going for. If you are doing, a search and rescue seeking and you want that really vibrant signal red to just leap out like it does on those things, sure, go for that. Go for that pop. But if you're going for just, a yellow fuselage band, or sorry, a yellow wing band on something like an Operation Torch aircraft, it doesn't necessarily need to be a beacon in the night. It can be a bit darker and a bit worn down. And a lot of times, if you look at the actual historical photos of these things, stuff like that, or stuff like tail codes on B-25s in the Mediterranean, they were kind of battered and beaten up. And so you want coverage, you want the yellow to show up over something like an olive drab, but you don't really necessarily need to put white under it if you have the right yellows. And the same goes for, a white finish on pretty much anything. T-38s, the undersides of pretty much any U.S. Navy or Marine aircraft from 1955 to the end of the 70s. I mean, all these things, they're going on to actual aircraft that are actually in use. And it's a matter of finding the right paint that will cover well, but that's no reason to be afraid of using black primer, as we will walk through here shortly. Now, my plan for this little demonstration is actually a demonstration in three or four parts, depending on how you break it down. So my first plan is to do just a straight up clean white. Imagine that we are painting a T-38 or some NASA test aircraft where it's, a nice, shut up compressor, where it's a nice, glossy, shiny, not degraded white. Nice and easy. This will require a bit of modification to the basic foundation, foundational process of black basing, but still totally doable. Next, we'll be doing a worn down, beaten up, dirty white. Something you might see on the bottom of, say, a A7 Corsair or an F4 Phantom, where it's seen some shit, and because it's seen some shit, it's got some shit on it. So we'll be playing with that and how you can build some of that into the undercoats before the white goes on. Then for parts 3 and 4, if you want to call it that, we're going to be putting yellow and red directly on top of black, just to show that it can be done. Now, again, it really depends on what you are trying to paint. If you want a just really bright, vibrant, shining out there color, you probably still want to put, white or something underneath it, just because that's one of the things that seems to be a factor in the black basing process, is the black. One thing that it will do, just by the nature of what it does, is it will pull back some of the saturation. I have it here. If you look at the first go around, where we have the pre-shading over here and the black basing over here, it's a very subtle difference, but the pre-shaded side is slightly more saturated than over here. And that's in large part because of the marbling and the very slight shifts in contrast and opacity over here that just trick the eye into seeing it a little bit duller than this side, which for a worn down military scheme is something that you want. But if you're going again for, you know, a search and rescue helicopter that is painted a bright glaring yellow, maybe not something you want to do. You know, maybe in that case it is worth putting a white undercoat under it. But again, it all comes down to the kit, the references, what you're trying to accomplish, etc. And that's a bit beyond the purview of what we're trying to do here. So my goal is simply to show that yellow and red can totally be painted over black. You know, again, depending on the need. So that's the plan, and let's get to it. Okay, so first up, we're going to do the basic white. And I'm literally going to use MRP4 basic white for the basic white. Now with this, I mean, you literally just paint it like any other color. Although since we're going for this clean white, we're not really going to worry so much about marbling. We're just going to go for a nice linear buildup of color. Okay, so spraying with Mr. Paint MRP4 Basic White is done. And as you can see here, we've got a nice, rather clean, uniform white going on the wing. Now, this would be an ideal, you know, ideal solution for something like a T-38 or a Cessna or other aircraft that are typically this clean, relatively shiny white. Now, I wouldn't necessarily recommend using MRP4 because, as you can hopefully see here, it's, you know, it's nice and smooth, but it's not the shiniest white out there. I would go for more of a semi-gloss or a gloss white as opposed to this relatively satin shade that's happening here. But this is, you know, proof enough that you can easily put white down over black and have it look fantastic. And the thing I like about the white over the black is even though it is white, it shows a very subtle hint of depth that you just don't seem to get putting white over gray. You know, there's a hint that there's more to this than just white paint over plastic. It seems to have a bit more of something else going on. And that seems to me especially more true as you get into the shinier whites. The MRP4 is a bit of a flat one in that regard. So, that is white over black. Let's move on and do some fun experiments with yellow and red over black. So, they say that you can't paint yellow over anything but white. Let's put that to the test. Thank you. Look at that. Yellow over black. No problem. Now let's say you want to have a slightly more battered yellow going on. Well, this is where black basing can come in and have some fun. As you can see here, you can marble yellow just like any other color. Although, this is one where I might recommend bringing in some different tones if you really want a nice, dirty yellow. You know, depending on what your complementary paint scheme is. If you're putting it over, say, olive drab, maybe you don't need much, because this is put right over olive drab. But if you're talking about, you know, say a tired old yellow search and rescue helicopter, you might want to put some desaturating elements here and there, some saturating elements here and there, so tans, oranges, whites, things to break it up. Now to go ahead and do some blending, we go back to wider spraying patterns. Okay, so here we've got yellow over black. Now, this front part here is just sprayed straight, no fucking around with any sort of marbling. Just get the yellow on there, build up coverage just like we did with the white. As you can see, it has no problem with saturation, with color depth, with brightness, any of that. This is, you know, the label's wrong. This is RAF marking yellow. It's exactly what we're going for. So this would be what you would have on the leading edges of Spitfire wings and things like that. Back here, this is more marbled and battered, as you can see. And so this would be something, you know, if you were doing, say, a Operation Torch Allied aircraft, you might want to do something like this to sort of show the tiredness and the, you know, harsh conditions it's going through, the foot traffic on top of the wing, that sort of thing. And of course, from here, you can bake in additional weathering after you get through with the painting process. So, they say you can't paint yellow on top of black. I say, yeah, you can. Okay, so far we've shown that we can do white over black, yellow over black. What about red over black? Now, the labels on these two somehow got swapped. So, this is actually the RAF marking yellow, MRP 122. This is actually this insignia red for U.S. Navy training in Arctic or Arctig camo, MRP 2. It's a very, as you can see, very vibrant red. So if anything's going to tamp it down, it's going to be putting it over black, right? Well, let's go ahead and have some fun. So I'm going to do similar to what I did with the yellow, where I'm going to put the just a straight up color down on this leading edge panel and then do some marbling back here. And I've also put down some yellow just to show how you can play with different marble coats to alter the way that things look. So here we go. Now, one thing I will say is that the red, when it goes over the black, unlike the yellow, it seems to kind of go, the only way I can describe it is kind of tomato-y. It's again, it's that desaturation from going over the black, which, depending on what you're doing, may be exactly what you're looking for. But, you know, as I've been saying, if I wanted this to really pop, kind of like this crazy color here in the cup, I'd probably put this over white and yellow just to build that color faster. Now we're going to have our fun with marble coats. So, I mean, honestly, unless you have real cause for doing like a dark mottled red, I mean, honestly, I wouldn't really recommend marbling for red. It's kind of silly. It works really nicely for yellow. If you're doing it for red, I would maybe build up through some different colors other than just over black, just because of the nature of the contrast between the two. You know, by all means, start with black, but then add yellow or add tan or whatever you're trying to go for, because, you know, this can be done, but I can't think off the top of my head of too many examples where you see a really heavily battered red on a vehicle. But, you know, it has its applications. You can see here as you fill it in, the blend coat. Yeah, it looks nice. It's hard to deal with this reflection. I mean, it's got a nice tone to it for sure. But, I mean, I can't think off the top of my head of any particular subject that has that really, you know, dark, saturated red going on in a worn-down, mottled fashion. I'm sure there's something, though. And then when we blend with this orange up here, definitely a more vibrant color going over yellow than going over black. And you can really see it here. Okay, so here is red over black. Now, whoever said that you can't spray red over black, yeah, you can. The leading edge here, just like the yellow sprayed on, you know, no screwing around with marble coats, anything like that, just painted. And it definitely goes on. I would say it's not quite as vibrant as you could possibly get. Shut up, compressor. But that's totally fine, because you don't necessarily always want super vibrant. And so it's something to consider when you're dealing with various schemes. You know, if you want, you know, like a racing aircraft, or you're going for a search and rescue helicopter, something like that, yeah, you obviously want the most vibrant red possible. But if you're dealing with, you know, some Mustang in the middle of the European front and it had a red spinner and that thing has seen some shit, something like this might be a better option. Now, the marbling, I would say, does not work quite as well with red as it does with yellow. Yellow holds together quite well. Red, less so. You know, I can't, mainly because I can't think of a reason. You don't see a lot of red bands or things like that going on aircraft that I'm aware of. You do see plenty of yellow bands, you know, again, thinking to Operation Torch and the stripes that aircraft wore, things like that. You see it some in the Pacific Theater as well with P-47Ns and whatnot, where you maybe want that slightly beat-up yellow look. And using marbling and maybe a different color underneath to help support as well. You know, this is just yellow over black, but you can see how this is more uniform and this gets a bit more into a slightly battered, decayed, distressed yellow. Red, you can do that as well. I mean, you can see it here. The thing is, I can't think of really any instances where you would need to. Now, up here, this is red over... So essentially, it's black, marbled yellow, marbled red, and then red blended on top. So you get this, you know, much more vibrant, but also mottled and kind of distressed red. Maybe something you might want to consider for a Hinomaru or something like that that has seen better days. Again, though, red typically seems to be just a straight-up sprayed color, so it can go over black, especially if what you're after is not a super vibrant, super saturated look. So thinking about, you know, Aria fin flashes and roundels and things like that, this is fine. Yeah, so that's that. So let's get on to moving to the other side where we are going to do a distressed white. Okay, so before we start work on the dirty white wing, I want to walk through a little concept. This is basically the core of black basing, but, you know, it might help to visualize it this way. So if you think about this side here as 100% black, over here, 100% white. So we've got some white, we'll put it here. Got some black, we'll put it here. Now, these are about as far apart as you can get in terms of contrast from each other. So when you're thinking about other things that you might be black basing, for example, you know, a sort of medium gray, that might sit right here in the middle. And then if you were doing something pretty dark, you know, some Soviet AMT 12 gray, that's going to be more on this side. So that might sit here. This might sit here. And of course, white's all the way over here. And then you've got colors like, you know, SEA camo brown. They're going to sit, you know, more towards this side, but, you know, maybe right in here. Okay. Now, basically, what you want to do when it comes to black basing is you want to start at zero and essentially work, damn Sharpie, work your way toward whatever color you're looking for. So, you know, if you're going for this SEA brown right here, you know, this is full coverage, you want to end up maybe somewhere in here as an overall opacity. Obviously some parts will be 100% opaque, other parts will be back in here, and this range that you establish is what leads to the contrast variation that builds that character into the surface. And then if you start adding other colors in along the way, that changes up the tonal variation as well. And then if you're doing something like the AMT 12 gray over here, you obviously have a much narrower window to make that happen, which is why some people out there say that it's, you know, you can't really black base, or the black basing doesn't work as well with dark colors. It's just you have a narrow window to play with. When you have white, you have the whole, you know, 0 to 100 range to play with. And you need to bring things much, damn Sharpie, much further this way. So you ultimately want to end up somewhere like in here, which requires putting more paint over the black. Or it requires putting in your marble coat, bringing a lot of, you know, colors in this range. So SEA brown and tan and, you know, maybe even some field green. You know, there's a lot of different colors that you can bring in depending on how you want to dirty up a white to sort of soften the intense contrast that you get with the black, and build up to a layer that's, you know, maybe your starting point, instead of being all the way over here, is closer to the middle. And so that shifts what you need to do in terms of working out the opacity and the contrast. And this applies pretty much across the board, whatever color you want to throw out there. You're gonna kind of have to, for a color like yellow, for example, figure out where in this slide, in the spectrum, it happens to sit in terms of brightness and darkness. So this, you know, this may sit over here. Red's going to shift a little bit this way, which is why you don't really have quite as much workability with red as you do with yellow. Anyway, that moves us into how to attack a dirty white wing. You know, we've already done clean white right here. We've already done yellow and red. So when it moves into dirty white, so I've got this thing precariously perched on the stand. All right. So when it comes to a dirty white, it's a matter of bringing in various dirtying colors. So I'm going to say that's going to be warm grays, some browns, and if I can find a color I'm happy with, maybe even some pale greens, more of like pale drab colors, just to do some really interesting things to bring that marbling layer from black up into, you know, the middle territory and even skirting this way a bit. And then from there, we build the white on top to bring it the rest of the way and have it be identifiably white, but still have that sort of dirtied up, grungy look going on. So with that, let's get to painting. Okay, so to start things out on this wing, I'm going to begin with one of my favorite color shades out there that Mr. Paint actually doesn't make yet, which is Gunn's C69 Off-White. This is a wonderful color. It's almost white, but not quite, and it's not quite in just that perfect, dirty sort of way. It's one of those I've tried mixing off-whites before, and they never seem to quite come out the way I want, and this stuff is just there from the beginning, so... Okay, so here we've got a good foundation of Gunn's C69 Off-White, on which we can start building in other tones before we come back with a blend coat to make this a nice, dirty-looking white wing. In the meantime, I thought it'd be interesting to show you. That is how much paint I used. This thing was filled to the brim, and now it's barely not. So, huzzah for black basing and very frugal paint usage. Okay, so now that we've got the off-white on the wing, it's time to start adding in some different tones to dirty things up a bit. So I'm literally grabbing colors at random just to have some fun with this, and I'm gonna start with this Warsaw Pact gray-green. It's a nice sort of paler green tone, not quite as pale as I would like. So what I'm gonna do is put a little bit of that in one of the tattoo ink cups, and then we're going to fuck it all up with some German beige. Because we want a little bit of that green tone, but just a hint. Don't want any more than that. So, got those two in there, and because I want these to be more on the supporting side, also going to drop in some Mr. Leveling Thinner. Not much, because Mr. Paint is already nice and thin out of the bottle, and we don't want to have a bunch of spiders everywhere. And here's this color to play with. So we're going to load this into the airbrush. And with these colors, we don't want them quite as uniform across as we have the off-white. We want them in certain places, just providing accents. So, I need a little bit more air pressure than that.
go. All right.
Now, one thing I would suggest when you're painting additional colors into the marble coat like this is to use colors that are close to the same, essentially contrast value. If you think of that 0 to 100 drawing that I did, get them, you know, close-ish in contrast value, because that way you're not fighting to cover up something obscenely dark like, where the hell did it go? You know, something obscenely dark like a glossy blue that's going to just fuck all this all to hell. You want stuff that's, you know, like with like, so when you cover it, you're putting about the same amount of effort into covering it as you are into this sort of mottled white that we have going on. So because this is my most shifted color from the white, I'm going to play it very conservative with it. And I'm going to say that is good enough there and move on to a few other shades. All right, so next up we're going to put in some of this SEA brown. Definitely more of a fleshy red shift than some of the other colors floating around right now. Okay, so I'm going to call this one pretty damn good. And now we're going to move on to the next color. Okay, so next up we're going to do this Mr. Paint Tan. Just another shade in the mix. This is definitely a brighter color than the SEA Brown. You put them side by side, you can see a world of difference going on here. Because this one is so light, I'm not afraid to go a little bit heavier with it and using it as more of a marble coat than I was with the others. This is where we really start to crush the opacity down before the blend coat, because white, you know, again, as that chart demonstrated, white is really far away from black. And so to crush that opacity down, you either have to do it in this stage or you have to do it in the blend coat when the white goes on. And the more that we can do it here, the more we can hold back on the white and make sure some of these tones carry through. Okay, so now we've got the wing where we want it with the marble coat. So we've got, as you can see across the entire surface here, obviously the black primer still showing through just a little bit, the off-white base on top of it, and then we've got the multicolor stuff going on with the gray-green and beige, the SEA brown, and the tan, just sort of modeled across, emphasizing certain areas. You know, we've got the wing fold line here, we've got some extra stuff, you know, separate colors on the gun doors, on different panels, essentially breaking it up so it's not just a uniform modeling of all the same stuff across the entire surface. Now I'm going to go back with the guns off white. I've topped it up with thinner, and we're going to do some blending. All right, here we go. Thank you. But the goal with this whole thing is to bring that overall opacity, which if maybe it was at 60% before we started adding the white down, to bring it up closer to where that white is. So filling in slowly, letting us see how it looks as the white settles a little bit. Okay, so with that, I'm going to call this particular wing done. And as you can see, it's, you know, compared to the basic white over here that is very uniform, very clean, this is a much dirtier, grungier, dingier white that has obviously seen some shit. And part of that comes down to the fact that we are using, guns off-white versus Mr. Paint Basic White, and they are rather different shades. But at the same time, a lot of that comes to the use of black basing and marbling and all the colors that we have supporting this white underneath. I mean, they're very subtle at this point, but if you look really closely, you can see some of these hints of, you know, tans and greens and things like that. They're in there very, very slightly, just providing a little supporting lift to give this color more depth and character than it would if you just sprayed it, you know, gray primer, bomb on the white. So, for the right aircraft, for the right purposes, if you're going for a dirty white, you know, maybe you're talking about a, particularly beat up Coast Guard helicopter or something like that, here's an option. You know, or if you're looking at, say, invasion stripes or some of the banding on various fighters that was that, you know, white color that stuck around for a while. If you put this white on there, it's going to stand out like crazy, and those things got rather dirty. So this white might be a better choice. You might also want to consider a white like this for the dirtier high-vis Navy and Marine schemes, you know, F4 Phantoms and the like. Again, it depends on what you're going for, just like everything else we're testing here. Now, just for kicks, I'm going to yank the off-white out of the airbrush, and we're going to go layer some Mr. Paint Insignia White on top of part of the wing, just to show the difference of what happens with different whites. I think I'm just going to carry it across this section. So as you can see, especially on that leading edge there, the Insignia White is a little bit whiter than the off-white. And because of that, we can get slightly brighter color, if you will, this off-white, particularly in comparison to the basic white, is almost looks like a light gray, even though it's just an off-white. The Insignia White being a little bit whiter jumps it up a little bit. So if you want to do this dirty wing, but maybe have it not be quite this dirty, just do all the steps that we walked through here, you know, the basing, the black basing with the primer, the foundational marble coat. You can use off-white if you want, you can use Insignia White, you can use basic white if you felt like it. Build in some colors, and then come over on top gently and blend it in and get to this sort of, you know, dirty, gnarly looking white but maybe have it be as dirty and gnarly looking, but a little bit more vibrant than what the off-white gives. Again, it really depends on what you're trying to go for, in terms of a paint scheme and in terms of your subject. But there are always options. So that's that. Okay, so we've just gone a few rounds painting really light colors over black primer. And what have we learned? Well, thing number one is the dogma that's out there that you can't put certain colors over dark colors is pretty much crap, especially if you have paints that can cover. So yeah, if you're using something like, you know, a Vallejo Air Yellow, you're going to run into problems just because as a paint, it doesn't have that much coverage capability. But if you're using something like Guns or particularly Mr. Paint, coverage over black is just not a problem. These things build coverage very linearly, so you can put it on there as almost a filter, or with a few more passes, you can build all the way up to full opacity. Now, lighter colors do, you know, you are going to have to use more paint to cover black than if you were spraying something like an olive drab, mainly because you have just a greater distance to go between white and black. You know, it's, you're going from, you know, zero as pure black up to 100, which is pure white or pure whatever your color happens to be. And the lighter the color, the greater that distance is going to be. So the more you have to bring it up the way it is. So anyway, on this side, we painted full coverage, basic white, you know, no marbling of any kind, just a nice white paint job. And as you can see, it's white. The sink mark in the aileron really shows up this way. God, I would not want to fix that if I was actually building this. Anyway, you know, you may be asking what this has over, say, a gray primer or a white primer. I mean, honestly, it's not all that much. I think the black adds just a little hint of depth that you don't see in a gray primer, and especially not in a white primer with white on top of it, where, you know, if you look at it from certain angles, it's so damn bright that it's throwing the camera sensor off. But if you look at it from certain angles, it has just a little hint of depth that when you carry it across a whole model, you know, if you were building like a, kind of wish somebody made a 1/32 scale T38, you know, but even a 1/48 scale, carried across the whole model, it's very easy for those things when you're painting them white to just look like die-cast toys. That extra little bit of depth gives it something else. It gives it a little bit more character and helps really hold it together. Now on the red and the yellow, again, full coverage down on the leading edges, totally possible, totally easy. I would say yellow works a little better than black, or sorry, yellow works a little better than red, just because red tends to, you know, desaturate a little bit and goes what I can only describe as a little bit tomato-y, as opposed to putting it over other shades. You know, you can see the leading edge here versus back here where it's over a model of yellow. It definitely has a, you know, another level of vibrance when you put it back there. So if you're going for more of a doled out red, something, you know, something like a P-47 in World War II with a red cowl, or, you know, a red rudder, things like that, where it wasn't really the vibrancy you would see out of, say, a search and rescue helicopter, just putting it over black is fantastic. Now, if you're going for, again, a search and rescue helicopter or something with a very bright, vibrant, highly saturated red, you may want to put it under, or put it, you know, put a white or a yellow or something under it to give it that extra oomph. With yellow, honestly, I see no reason to paint it over anything but black, especially for military aircraft, you know, propeller tips or fuselage stripes on Operation Torch aircraft, you know, the various yellow things on RAF and Luftwaffe and Japanese aircraft. If you put white under it, it can very easily get too bright and really overpower what's going on around it. This way, you know, if you just put it over black, or if you put it over a dark color like an olive drab, it blends a little better. I mean, it's still nice and bright. You're not losing the yellow in the paint. It's right there. It's just maybe not quite as overpowering as it could be. So anyway, with these colors, if you have, you know, if you're using the right paint brands that can provide that coverage, you're golden over black, or yellow as the case may be. On this other side, this is a dirty white. It's really hard to capture in the glare of these lights. But essentially what we did here was we put down a foundational marbling of gun C69 off-white, and then some tans, some greens, and browns, and then came over top with a really thin blend coat of the off-white until we got to this level. And this is the kind of thing, you know, if you're thinking about a really, you know, sort of a banged up, dirtier U.S. Navy, U.S. Marine Corps high-vis aircraft where the white is, you know, it's white, it still needs to be clean-ish, but it definitely has been through some shit. Something like this is a great option where you can provide that little bit of extra character and depth. And you don't want, you know, you don't want like the greens and the browns shining through like a beacon. Like here, you know, I very obviously put things underneath. But you just want that little hint that there's more going on than just, you know, spray bombing white on the bottom of a Phantom. So this kind of approach can get you there. It can get you that nice, you know, it's, yeah, it's white, but it's white that is not this white over here. Now, in the middle of this, right down this little bar here, I sprayed an extra layer of Mr. Paint Insignia White just to show that, you know, it's slightly more vibrant, slightly brighter than the gun's off-white, which, you know, it's a little bit creamy, as you can see here. Still, either of them work great for this purpose. And so if you want to do a dirty white, again, depending on the aircraft you're building and all that, you know, all those typical caveats apply, it's a great solution. It's a great way to build in that little bit of extra color and start thinking about not only what the top color looks like, but what you can put into it underneath in almost a, you know, in almost a subliminal fashion to add extra depth and extra character to the paintwork. And one thing this will really do is when you start putting, when you start putting markings down on it, so when you start putting, you know, the US stars and bars or something like that on here, that is a whole different vibrant contrasty color to the white. And if you have, you know, just a basic white, it can easily crush that down into being just a sheet of white. Even if you use off-white, it can make it look like this over here, which you may not want. So dirtying up the paint and giving it something slightly different and slightly more characterful than just a blank canvas can help that color hold its own against those markings. But we'll get to the whole tonal crush thing here in a little bit. So anyway, light colors over black, totally doable. You know, definitely worth practicing getting a feeling for it. But once you do, sky's the limit. So with that, I am going to move on to the next demonstration in the series. And thanks for watching. Hope you enjoy it. And if not, why the hell are you still watching? Talk to you later.